Thank you for joining Pastor Curtis and Joy for this message. If you would like to hear more from Pastor Curtis or Joy, please check them out on their Coker Ministries YouTube channel. Also, please like and subscribe if these messages are a blessing to you. You can also visit their webpage at cokerministries.com. God bless you. Have a great day. This ministry functions on the support of our listeners. We appreciate your prayers and your financial blessings. Your support also helps us to continue to share this message of grace, peace, and Christ's righteousness in the finished work of the cross. You can give online at cokerministries.com, or you can mail your support to or prayer requests to Coker Ministries, 15239 555th Avenue, Parkers Prairie, Minnesota, 56361. We pray God's blessings over you. Remember, if you are in Christ, you are blessed, highly favored, and so very deeply loved. Again, thank you for joining us in the Word. Be blessed.
Hallelujah. Real quickly, while she's setting that up, we're on Facebook and other things, so that's why we do this. But Bert, you sent out a text about questions. Did anybody have, this is what is called a freedom fellowship. This is not a church service, okay? This is what Joy and I do this. This is what we do. We've been pastors for, we've been in the ministry for 35, 40, we lost count, lots of years. We've pastored churches. So our goal is not to get you to believe what we believe. Our goal as a teacher is to cause you to think about what you believe and then let the Holy Spirit teach you. So don't think we're being dogmatic about anything. I was in the Methodist minister for a while, and I learned there that they had a great reverence for God, but no relationship with the Father. You know what I'm saying?
Can you speak up a little bit? Because when the cars go by, I can't hear a thing you're saying.
Okay, we'll just pray that no cars go by. No, I can speak up.
That could be the birds.
And yeah, something. And then, you know, I was in the faith movement. I reeled it for a while, and I met Joy in Tulsa, Oklahoma, back in the mid-80s, back when it was hot faith, you know, word explosions. And I realized there that they had a relationship with the Father, but no reverence for God. And then I realized Paul's writing, he says, grace and peace to you from God are... It was both. It wasn't this or this. It was both. And so we've been learning as... You know, I explained to a group of people last night in Fergus Falls, every one of you and us, we have a pie plate. Your life is like a pie plate. And there has been different people come along your path, different people than I've had. And I've gotten different, we've been blessed. They've left pieces of pie in our pie plate. And so what we know today is accumulation of those pieces of pie. And I believe the more pieces of pie you have, a better rounded understanding you have of Scripture. If you just have one big pie, you don't understand. If all you've done is listen to one type of teaching all your life, you're missing all the other facets of God that are out there. It's not a matter, listen to me, it's not a matter of being wrong and right. I'd rather be, if you're going to, would you rather be the rightest church in town or the most loving church in town? Yeah. Because I guarantee you, there's nobody here that can say that everything they've always known has always been right. I'll call you a liar. You know, we've learned as we've gone. You know, and the more facets you have, does anybody know what a incandescent? I mean, here's the old fashioned light. Yeah, I look around. There may be one person here that doesn't know what a, you know, an old light bulb is. That, and I'm not going to point him out. He's on the front row, but But did everybody know the old light bulbs that had a filament in between? And do you know how they work, right? There's a positive pole and a negative pole, correct? The light doesn't come from this pole, and it doesn't come from this pole. It comes from the activity that happens between the poles. And what we have in what I call churchdom, and you can spell it how you want to, is that you have this group of people over here saying, our standard is right, we believe is right, and they're wrong. And these people over here are saying, what we believe is right, and they're wrong. And we're holding up these standards of right and wrongness, and we're missing the point. See, Jesus is the Alpha and the... He's not the Alpha. He's not the Omega. He's both. He's the activity in between. That's where the light and the energy, that's where the life comes from. He's the beginning and the... See, in the Methodist Church, Jesus was a lamb. They focused on Jesus being the lamb. In the faith movement, he's a lion. Well, which one is he? He's the lion and the lamb. He's both. So there's wisdom that comes from this one, and there's wisdom. So what I'm saying in this is that the more aspects, the more pieces of pie that you have in your pie pan, the better understanding you're going to have of the magnitude of God. He's a many-faceted God. You can't no one, and we're going to get into this here a little bit later, but does anybody know in 1 Corinthians 13, the Apostle Paul said, matter of fact, let's just read that real quick. Joy's going to put it on the board. 1 Corinthians chapter 15.
15, he said?
1 Corinthians 15. No, 13, excuse me. 1 Corinthians 13. Hopefully this answers a lot of people's questions about certain things. Does anybody know what's in the 1 Corinthians 13? It's known as the love chapter. Oh, there's so much more in there than love, but listen to this. We're going to start with verse 8. Love never fails. But whether there are prophecies, there will fail. Whether there are tongues, they will cease. Whether there is knowledge, it will what? Vanish away. Anybody heard that scripture before?
Yeah.
Okay. For we know in part, and we prophesy in part. Verse 10. But when that which is perfect has come, then that which is in part will be done away. But now he's saying we know in part. Didn't he just say that? And that which perfect comes, that which is in part will be done away. A lot of people believe that's talking about the Bible. It's not the Bible it's talking about. It's talking about the kingdom of heaven coming to this earth. That's what is perfect. Jesus did not promote the Bible. He promoted the kingdom of heaven on this earth. That was his message. He was talking about the coming of the kingdom of heaven. Let me keep reading that to show you that's what it's talking about. But when that which is perfect has come, then that which is in part will be done away. When I was a child, we can't get into that. Boy, I tell you, we could. When I was a child, I spoke as a child. I understood as a child. I thought as a child. But when I became a man, a mature person, I put away childish things. Matter of fact, in the book of Hebrews, it says that you're a child if you're still drinking milk. Okay? Not just regular milk. It's talking about the law. If you're under the law and you're just focused on the law, you're a child and have not grown up to take the word of righteousness. Let's go ahead and talk about this. Verse 12 says, for now, say now. So we have two words really focused on, part and now. So in the period of time called now is in the time called part. Do you understand that? For now we see in a mirror what? Dimly. We don't see things perfectly. If you think you're perfect in what you believe, the Apostle Paul didn't even. Give me some kind of break. Well, he's saying right here, but when? Now. And he just said that we knew things in part. We didn't need, you don't know the whole. You understand? For now we see in a mirror, when? Now. But then, say then. We're going to see him face to face.
Woo-hoo.
So what we have is two time periods. One called now, which everything is dimly and in part. But then, and when's then? Let's fill in the gaps. Can you get a timeline out here in front of you? So here's Calvary. Here's the resurrection. Guess when is then you're going to see him face to face? Don't say when you die and go to heaven. This is talking about...
No.
This is talking about...
Is that a bird?
Yes. Ooh. Okay. For now, we see in a...
There's a timeline.
Okay. For now, we see in a mirror what? Dimly. But then, you're going to see him what? Face to face. So this period of time is when you see Jesus face to face. And what's going to happen? Now, I know him. Put the scripture back up. Okay. Now, the time period that Paul is in, and now, that's one we're in now. Now, I know in part, because that's the time period. We're in the time period called part and now. But then I will see, and then I shall know just as I also am known. And now abideth faith, hope, and love. These three, but the greatest of these is what? Guess what? There's a period of time that you're in now. You ever wonder why some people... You pray for and they get healed, and some people don't? You ever wonder why some prophecies are right on and some aren't? You ever wonder why you minister deliverance to somebody and some get delivered and some don't? If you've been active in the Spirit at all, these things you've asked questions. Mm-hmm. See, some people believe that healing is not for today because they believe that the atonement, the healing there, is talking about spiritual healing and not physical healing. Then there's people that believe that, well, because if it's in the atonement, this Isaiah 53, we're going to get there, that everybody you pray for should be healed. That's been my problem over my lifetime. The Bible says do it. The Bible says it's going to happen. Guess what? It doesn't happen all the time. I'm just being real. I'm not getting you to doubt your faith. I'm not getting you to doubt the Word of God. I'm here to help you understand that you're in a period of time called now, and you know things in part. You're going to prophesy in part. See, you're not going to need your prayer language when you see him face to face because you can talk to him. You're not going to need prophesy because he's the spirit of prophecy. You're not going to need knowledge because you'll have the mind of Christ in fullness. You're not going to need this stuff that God gave us to operate in the now because then... you'll be with him. So we need to understand that we're in the now. And you're going to see things dimly. People that... I don't love people. I mean, I enjoy people that think they know it all. Because it doesn't take long for me to expose that they don't. They know what they know according to their pie that they have. And guess what? There is nobody on the planet Earth that God is waiting for to get to heaven and go, oh, you made it. You're finally here. You're the only one that knew everything about me. There's nobody here. Unless you think. But their churches are full of people like that. They think they know everything there is about God and they don't need to know anything else. They're not willing to take their mind because their ego's in the way.
So I think that the only one that claimed that in the scripture was Luke. Luke said when he wrote Luke that he possessed all, he knew how everything was from the beginning.
Wow.
he understood the prophecies and everything, and that's why he could provide a detailed account.
Yeah, but he doesn't know all. He didn't know all the aspects of God.
No.
See, there is so much more. The Holy Spirit is here to teach us. Matter of fact, do you realize that Jesus had to leave? Turn to John chapter 16. John chapter 16. And by the way, we are so open to any comments. Matter of fact, we're going to open up for questions here in a second. John chapter 16, verse 7. Is it up there? Let me know when. Okay. Nevertheless, I tell you the truth, it is to your advantage that I go away. For if I do not go away, the Helper will not come to you. But if I depart, I will send him to you. Who's the Helper?
Holy Spirit.
Holy Spirit. And when he has come, he will convict the world of sin. Now you're going to stop and think about that for a second. You're saying, see, I have a friend of mine wrote a book. And I love the concept of the book. He said, sin's not the issue. It's the problem. See, the church makes sin the issue. But I thought Jesus took care of the sin issue. Wow. I give you many scriptures that tell us. In 1 John chapter 3, it says, Jesus was manifested to destroy the work of the devil, for the devil has sinned from the
beginning.
That's just a start. Did Jesus accomplish what he came to accomplish? Say yes. Well, we're going to talk about atonement tonight. We're going to talk about sanctification, justification, and reconciliation. So we got a long night. No, it's not going to be that long. Let me go ahead and read this. Read this. Verse 8, it says, and when he has come, he will convict the world of sin and of righteousness and of judgment. The next verse begins to clarify what that verse was talking about. Don't stop there. Verse 9, of sin because they do not believe in me. Do you realize the only sin that the Holy Spirit is convicting the world of is the sin of unbelief? See, we think sin in individual increments. Well, the problem with most people in churchdom today is they think that if you sin, you're a sinner. How many people, don't raise your hand. How many people in here are sinners saved by grace? Don't raise your hand. You were a sinner that was saved by grace. Now you're a saint that has a sin problem. But your sinning doesn't make you a sinner. Do you understand that? Your nature was changed. If you got born again, which means born from above, the same Spirit that raised Christ from the dead dwells in you. See, before that, you had the Spirit of Adam inside of you. You are Adamic nature. But when you got, that's why you had to get born again. That's why the whole purpose of baptism is to show that you were dead to your Adamic nature and being raised up in a new life into Christ. 1 Peter 1:23 literally says that when you've been born from above, it's you've been born not of corruptible seed, but what? Incorruptible seed. That word seed is a Greek word that explains, it's actually the word sperma. And if you're talking about a flower, and the word seed is called spora. They're both talking about the same thing. It's talking about the DNA of the donor. Within the spora, or the sperma, is the DNA of who it came from. And if you're born of God, you have the DNA, you have the seed of God inside of you called the Spirit. I don't know how deep I want to go into this, but that seed that's inside of you is incorruptible. Your nature's changed. Most people don't know that because they have not been taught that. Do you realize most people believe the gospel? Let me break it down real simple. Do you realize most people believe the gospel is about you believing in a certain thing so you can go to heaven for all eternity? That's not the gospel message. I'm not going to ask how many people here believe heaven, that you're going to go to heaven for all eternity. I'm not going to ask that. How many people believe that a person that doesn't believe is going to go to hell for all eternity? Don't raise your hand. You're trying to ask hands. If that's for me, I'm busy. Do you realize that hell is not forever? Do you realize, I'm going to say this one more time, you realize heaven is not forever? The Bible tells me there's going to be a new heaven and a new earth. Do you realize you're not going to go to hell for all eternity if you don't believe in Jesus when you die? You're going to go to hell for a temporary period of time. And then, after the millennial reign, you're going to stand before the great white throne of judgment and then get thrown into the lake of fire for all eternity. But that hell is going to go away. And see, you know this, but you don't put it together. Because we just look at the one piece of the pie and we don't consider everything else. Hell is like a county jail. And at the great white throne of judgment after the millennial reign, those that were in the county jail have to stand before their greatest judge, God. And then they'll be cast into the lake of fire for all eternity. Does everybody understand that? That's what the scripture says when you look at the fullness. See, the gospel, listen, the gospel, let me talk about it, here goes a car. The gospel is not about making bad people good. The gospel is about bringing life to dead people. Our job is not to live in a certain way to go to heaven someday. Our job is to find hell on earth and bring heaven to it. Why are we trying to get out of here? Do you realize even if you go to heaven, even if you die and go to heaven, you're coming back someday to rule and reign on earth in the millennial reign. You're not going to stay there. I tell that to people that go, well, I've heard that, but I've never seen that. You've heard about the millennial reign. You've read the scriptures in Corinthians. Back to the book of John here. Look what it says here in John chapter 16. Verse 9, of sin because they do not believe in me. Of righteousness because I go to my Father. Well, let's stop for a second. Of sin because they don't believe in me. That's the sin of unbelief. Does it say of unrighteousness?
No.
Does the Bible here say in red letters that Jesus spoke the Holy Spirit was going to come and convict people of their unrighteousness? No! Of righteousness, because I go to my Father and you see me no more. This is the job of the Holy Spirit. Of judgment. Ah, there we go. We got the whole world there. Judgment of God! Of judgment, because the ruler of this world is judged. Who's the ruler of this world? Don't say God. Jesus said the ruler of this world was Satan. Don't blame what's happening in this world on God's sovereignty. Please don't. I'll slap you. Nicely, of course, in love.
And that word is there, should that orally be, has been?
Judged. It he was judged thing. At Calvary. So let's go ahead and read the rest of it. I still have many things to say to you, but you cannot bear them now. What? I almost got kicked out of the Fergus Falls Bible study the first time we were there. We've been meeting in Fergus Falls for 9 years now. Once a month for 9 years, we've missed 2 months in 9 years. The first time I was there, I asked the people there, did Jesus teach truth? And everybody said yes. Did Jesus teach all truth? And they said yes. And I said, no, he didn't. The homeowner looked at me, almost got out of his chair. Brad Sunday, big fella. And I said, let's say that one more time. Did Jesus teach truth? And they said, he goes, yes. Did Jesus teach all truth? He said, yes. And I said, no, he didn't. I turned to the scripture and says, I still have many things to say to you, but you cannot bear them now. However, when he, the Holy Spirit of truth, has come, he will guide you into... You mean there's more truth that Jesus wants us to know and his disciples wanted, he wanted them to know, but they couldn't bear him now because they didn't have the Holy Spirit? Yes.
Doesn't that contradict? And I'm not disagreeing with you.
No, that's fine.
There's just this train of thought out there that, if it's not in scripture, then they just want to wipe out all prophetic words. And isn't this speaking to that then?
Oh, this is right? So denying that. Matter of fact, I can show you 27 different places in scripture. I won't do it tonight. In Galatians, it says this. It says the scripture foreseeing that God would not justify the Gentiles by the law. You know that scripture? Watch this. And this is just a teaser. Remember, and it's okay if you disagree with me.
And yes, to your question, yes, this does address that there is more than what
there's
they
more.
Had written
That's
down in paper.
That's a way to answer people who want to discredit prophecy today.
Right.
Yes.
Right.
Oh, gosh.
Yes.
Oh, gosh. Let me give you some more for that, okay? In Galatians chapter 3, verse 7. And by the way, again, my self-worth and value doesn't come from people agreeing or disagreeing. The problem I have is when people get their identity from their information. And when you challenge their information, you make them feel bad. And they get defensive. Now, see, we talked about it earlier, the right and wrongness. Where does being right and wrong come from? The knowledge, the tree of the knowledge of what? God said he didn't want man to even operate that way. See, it's not about... See, when we begin, as believers, when we begin to quit asking, well, is this God's will or not God's will? Is this right or is this wrong? What tree are you eating of? Quit it. The question you need to ask yourself is this righteous? Righteousness is a much higher realm of living than wrong or rightness. The world lives in wrong or rightness. Everything Adam did before he sinned was righteous. Everything. Everything. He didn't have to ask God. Well, God gave him all the animals. And you name them. He didn't ask, well, God, what do you think? You know, we got Christians out there. God, what kind of toothpaste do you want me to have? Give me a break. Is this wrong or is this right? Quit it. Question is, well, is drinking wrong or smoking wrong? Stop it. What's righteous? Oh. See, what's righteous for you may be unrighteous for me. I'm a diabetic. I shouldn't be eating ice cream.
You have diabetic symptoms.
I have diabetic symptoms. Thank you. So let's go ahead and read this real quick. In Galatians, back to this thing. Galatians chapter 3. You go home and read the rest of this if you want to. Verse 7. Therefore know that only those who are of faith of the sons of Abraham... are sons of Abraham. And the scripture, say scripture. Foreseeing that God would justify the Gentiles by faith, preached the gospel to Abraham beforehand. What preached the gospel to Abraham? The scripture. You can't show me in scripture, in the written word, where Abraham heard the gospel.
Well, it says he believed God.
But it wasn't written. See, some people, what she's addressing is, see, the scripture is more than the written scripture. The scripture is God's word, whether it's written or not. 27 different places, I show you in scripture, where it makes reference of scripture, but you can't find it back in history.
In what we have.
In what we have. There are some people believe it's not written in red. They don't go any... If it's not written in red, they don't believe it. Jesus just said there's more that he wants them to know that's going to come through the Holy Spirit. And that's why... I don't care if people speak in tongues. I don't care if they prophesy. Just don't talk negative about the Holy Ghost. If you talk negative about the Holy Spirit, you're talking about one third of God. And Jesus sent him here to teach us. And if you dishonor him, see, in your life, you'll only get from whom you honor. You understand that? You'll never receive from your parents. Oh, how's that say? Children, honor your father and mother. Because honor is what connects you to the anointing. Jesus was the most anointed person on the planet, but the people in his own hometown didn't receive his gift because they didn't what? Honor that anointing. Husbands, if you don't honor your wife, you'll never get their gift manifested in your family. Wives, if you don't honor your husband, you'll never get that gift that God's given them in your family. The anointing works through honor. So the most powerful thing on the planet is not the anointing. It's you honoring it. Because it will never break your honor. Wow. So, what we're going to do tonight, and by the way, I'm open for all kinds of comments. Bert sent out a thing saying if you have questions, you can either ask them or we can give them to us and we'll prepare to teach on some of those subjects in the future, however you want to do it. And so does anybody have any pertinent questions right now from what we've shared or whatever? Open house. Remember, this isn't, you're not going to get kicked out. The ushers aren't going to ask you to move. You know, it's all good.
For the most part of the Lord's ministry.
Ron, can you speak up? Can't hear you.
Greatest part of Yeshua's ministry was to believe in him.
Yes.
Yes. Because that's the nature of believing. And what you believe will become
that's
one with that
which you believe. That's right. Amen. Does everybody understand John chapter 17? See, this is the goal. What Ron just shared was the goal that Jesus really had for coming to earth. Turn to John chapter 17, verse 20. This is one of the most phenomenal. This is what is known as, I'm going to shock you with this one. This is the most pertinent Lord's Prayer in Scripture. But you've never heard it referred to as the Lord's Prayer. You think there's only one Lord's Prayer. The Lord's Prayer that you're aware of is an old covenant prayer, not a new covenant prayer. If you're curious, I can explain that later. This is why Jesus came. Let's read this in verse 20. I do not pray for these alone, but also for those who will believe, that's what Ron said, that will believe in me through their word. Talking about the disciples' words. That they all may be what? One. As you, Father, are in me and I in you, that they also may be one in us. What? See. What makes you one? We're talking about the word atonement tonight. The word atonement is a compound word. Does everybody know what a compound word is? The word atonement is made up of two words. And you have to understand the two words to understand what it's made up of two words. I think she's going to put it up there. One of the words is atone. This is a real hard definition of a word to understand. Just look the way it's spelled. At one. That's the definition. Atone means to be at one with someone. You're atoned. What's this? It says that they all may be one. See, Adam was at one with God, his creator, in the beginning. God breathed his spirit into clay, and man became a living nephes, a living soul, three-part being, spirit, soul, and body. He was created in the image and the what? Likeness. And when he sinned, he lost the likeness. He lost the spirit. God made everything reproduce after what? Its own kind. And so when Adam and Eve began to produce children, if they would have produced children before they sinned, the children would have had the Spirit of God in them. But they didn't. God created man. Say man. And then man just became a hue of what he used to be. A hue man. God didn't create humans. He created man. And sin, when man lost the spirit is what the lack of having the spirit separated him. God could not be in communion with someone that wasn't like him. That's why you have to get the spirit back inside of you so you can be at one again. You can be atoned. Atonement is made up of two words. One, atone, meaning at one. But the word meant literally means the process in which, she's got it up here, the process in which something is accomplished. So atonement gives us the idea that, wait a minute, you were at one with somebody, but now you're not. And atonement is the process in which it brings you back into that relationship that originally started. I'm going to use Bert as an example. It's like Bert and I are really close, good friends. And Bert has a business. And let's say Bert's business was building brick walls. And I hired Bert and his business to come build a brick wall for me because he's my friend. I wanted to help him out. And as he was building the wall and it hadn't dried yet, my dog walked past the brick wall and the brick wall fell and killed my dog. Doggone it, right? Just kidding. Just kidding. And so, naturally, I'm going to do what most Americans do. I'm going to sue Bert for the value of my dog. And to understand atonement, you have to understand this process. And so the court's going to award me the money that my dog cost and the price. Because and that you got the word up there?
Expiation.
The word is expiation. And that's a legal term, meaning, and once he's paid that bill, the financial bill for what he was responsible for, he has been it's been expiated. It's been taken care of. But we still got a problem because my heart is still broken over my dog. I still have a problem with Bert personally. And that word is taking care of what is known as propitiation. You ever heard that word before? Propitiation is the process which is making amends between two people. See, the price was paid by the
expiation,
but the emotions are taken care of by the propitiation. Being atonement is the you can't have atonement without having both. It takes both. Now, you see this in the book of Leviticus chapter 16 called the Day of Atonement. We get a pattern of this in the Day of Atonement where there is two types of goats. You familiar with this? You've been in church any length? You understand? There's one called the Goat of the Lord. This is on the Day of Atonement. Every year, the Jews would celebrate the Day of Atonement with two goats. One goat is called the goat of the Lord. That goat is taken in. Five things take place to that goat. The hands are laid on the inside the temple. They lay hand. The priests lay hands on the head of the goat. Transfer the sins of the people, the Jewish people, into the goat. They wrap their arms around the goat and squeeze. It's called Gethsemane. That's a step two. It's called Gethsemane. And where was Jesus at when he was pressed? He was in the Garden of Gethsemane before he went to the cross. And they would press the sins into him. And then they would cut the goat's throat. And they would say, "It is finished." Some people believe, like I believe, that the very time in Passover, when they cut the Passover lamb's throat and said, "It is finished," Jesus on the cross at the same exact time said, "It is finished." At the same time. We're not going to get into that. So we need to understand that that is representing, say the word again, Joy.
Expiation.
My mouth doesn't work good that way. Expiation. That is taking care of the price, that the blood pays the price for sin. But during the Day of Atonement, you have a bunch of, all these people, 300 plus thousands people, there at Jerusalem are quiet and they're not saying a word while that is going on. And then there's this what is called the scapegoat. You've heard the term scapegoat. That goat's name literally is Azazel. Azazel is a name that has two meanings. One of the meaning is take him away. And the other meaning is weapon in the hand of the enemy. We'll explain that. And so every year, they had an opportunity to see the goat of the Lord pay the price for their sins. But there's another goat that represented their propitiation. They would take all their regrets. For all day long, they'd think about their regrets, their failures, their disappointments, all their emotional hang-ups and problems they had, their anger between God and what they thought God was with them, all the stuff that got in the way of a relationship. They would wrap a cord around, they would lay hands on the goat, the scapegoat. They would press Gethsemane. Instead of cutting its throat, they'd wrap a scarlet ribbon around its horns, cut off a piece and put it on the door handles of the temple. They would lead the goat out into the wilderness to die. And it was literally taking their regrets, their failures, their faults, their disappointments, all their feelings that were separating them. How about this one? They're not good enough. Anybody ever felt like they're not good enough? Every year, the Jewish people got to put that feeling on that goat and take them away. And they got a do-over every year. Now, what's really interesting is one year, the goat came back. Can you imagine a group of people? And how'd they know it was the same goat? Because it still had the ribbon wrapped around its head. And you'll find this in the Talmud, which is the oral. It's a written. There was oral laws that were written later. And it's in the Talmud. And from that point on, they took the goat out and threw it off a cliff. So it couldn't come back. Let's put practical application to this. What's it mean when a goat, your Azazel, your scapegoat, comes back that's carrying all your past with you, with it? Got a question. Who's the hardest people in your life to minister to? Can you say family? Wonder why? Because they know your past. You ever heard the phrase, "Don't let anybody get your..." That's where it comes from. Don't let anybody bring up your past. Because the name for Azazel is the weapon in the hand of the enemy. All the enemy has to do is bring up your past. Unless you understand true salvation and atonement. Remember, atonement is just not, salvation is just not about your sins being paid for by the blood, but it's all your regrets, all your failures, all the things that you think are keeping you separate from God. You're free from. Because you have atonement. Man, if we could just understand really what salvation is. because we need to understand that, see, there's a process of things that take place. Expiation, propitiation, put those together, you have atonement. And once there's atonement, there's what? Reconciliation. Turn with me to 2 Corinthians. 2 Corinthians chapter 5. Verse 17. Well, we got to start with verse 14. For the love of Christ compels us, because we judge thus, that if one died for all, then all died. And he died for all, that those who live should live no longer. Uh-oh, we got a problem here. Let me back up. And he died for all, that those who live, not everybody's living, are they? But he died for all. Is it God's will that all men be saved? Yes. He died for all. But not everybody's living. But those that are living, which are you, you wouldn't be here if you weren't born again. You wouldn't put up with this. And he died for all, that those who live should live no longer for themselves. Oh, this is our church full of selfish people that are just worried about them, themselves, and what they believe, what they want, having things their way. You know, most people in the body of Christ, matter of fact, I found out the largest denomination in the body of Christ. Does anybody know what the largest denomination is in the body of Christ? It spans all denominations. You can find it in any group of people.
You didn't tell it last night. You needed to tell it last night.
Well, that's all right. And we're not there last night now. It's the Church of the Ignorant Brethren.
The naysayers.
The Church of the Ignorant Brethren. The ones that don't know what they're supposed to know. Ignorant doesn't mean stupid. It just means unlearned. There's so many things we need to know in the body of Christ, and we're ignorant of it. Salvation is one of those. Salvation is not about saying some words out of your mouth and sealing your eternity for all, you know, your existence for all eternity. It's about believing, as Ron said, believing in your heart. Did the disciples? Who's got the bunny things? No one has them. Bert should be holding that up right now.
Joy's job.
Joy's job? I'm not looking that way.
Yeah, you better hold it, Bert.
One of the things I've asked Bible school students when I've taught in Bible schools is, when did the disciples get saved? Can anybody answer that question? When did the disciples get saved? Some people, the most common question is, when they follow Jesus. There's lots of people following Jesus, but they didn't believe. Got a question. Did the disciples believe that Jesus was going to be raised from the dead?
No, not a one.
Thank you. What's it say? How do you be saved? Romans 10, 9 and 10. That if you believe in your heart that God raised him from the dead, they didn't believe. Even after he was dead. Even when he was raised from the dead. The day he was raised from the dead, they didn't believe it. I know that's shaking. See, you got to think about these things. I'm trying to get you to open up your pie plate and let some other information in. Get you to think. My job of a teacher is to get you to think.
I need to make a pause. Because what this is, Curtis will sometimes take a rabbit trail, a rabbi trail. And so when he takes a rabbi trail and it's going too far off the topic, you raise that up so he can get back on topic.
Sometimes he's going the rabbit hole getting over to the other
field. God showed me a long time ago, as long as I catch the rabbit, it's okay to take those bunny trails. Okay. So let me just go ahead and read this here. Therefore, verse 17, Therefore, if anyone is in Christ, he is a... Say new. We're not talking... See, most people believe salvation is about having your spirit healed. No. You have the spirit of Adam in you until you're born again. Most people believe it's about adding Jesus to your life. Just ask Jesus to come into your life and he'll make things better. You ever heard that message? Mm-hmm. No. That's just like taking a baby with a dirty diaper and putting a clean one on the outside and walking around saying, it's clean. You hang around that baby for a while, you realize it's still stinky. And there's some believers in the church, or so-called believers, they're still stinky. Because they have not been changed. They have not been changed. They still have the Adamic nature and they just confessed Jesus, but they hadn't died to their old life. Salvation, the gospel is about you dying to your life and accepting the life of Christ. And you're not being selfish anymore. This right here says, and he died for all that those who live should live no longer for themselves. But for him who died for them and rose again. Therefore, from now on, we regard no one according to the flesh, even though we have known Jesus Christ according to the flesh, yet now we know him thus no longer. Therefore, if anyone is in Christ, he's a what? A new creation. Old things have passed away. Where? In your life? No, in the spirit. In the spirit realm, your nature's been changed. You're a new creature in Christ. Old things have passed away. Behold, all things have become new. Now, all things are of God, who has what? Reconciled. Say that word out loud. After the truck goes by. Now, all things are of God, who has reconciled us to himself through Jesus Christ and has given us the ministry of what?
Reconciliation.
You've heard this preached, yes.
So now we are royalty in the kingdom?
No. Let me get on with this. I'll talk about that later. Let me just throw this out there. Have you ever heard of the Bride of Christ?
We are.
We're the Bride of Christ.
We're not the bride. We're married to him. Usually they talk about a bride before.
No. Let me explain that. Because now you're talking about the now, but the then. We'll see him face to face. There's a theological concept that you need to understand to help you understand Scripture and the way things work. It's called now, but not yet. In Jewish culture, Joseph and Mary were married long before it was consummated. Once you make an agreement, see, she's shaking her head. You can make an agreement of marriage in a Jewish culture, but you're not really married. You're not consummated until you have personal intercourse.
Ready, and then
you can be married. You can be married as husband and wife for 2 years, and there's a period of time there where you're married, but not yet. You're now, but not. See. This is so cool. You need to understand this. In the, I'm sorry. I'm hold up the rabbit trail again. No. Let me just show you this because people don't understand this principle. Look at Hebrews chapter 6. And this is why we have, literally, we have freedom fellowships that last 5 and 6 hours sometimes because of these rabbit trails. I'm not going to keep you here this long because you'll leave. Poor Bert will be here by himself. Look at Hebrews 6. We're not going to get into the theological discussion about this. Verse 4. For it is impossible for those who were once enlightened to have tasted. Say tasted. Wow. and have the heavenly gift and have become partakers of the Holy Spirit. And have what? Taste. Say that word, tasted again. Tasted the good word of God and the powers of the age to come. So during this period of time, people have just tasted. You have never experienced the power of God to come. You've tasted it. You haven't really experienced the Word of God. You've just tasted it. We know in part and prophesy in part. It's like, I know every man in here is probably if you're the head of the household and you're a male, you are the official taste tester in your kitchen. Come Thanksgiving, who's sneaking in there trying to get him some? That's not the women. I make a mean brisket, smoked brisket. And I've got men I got a name in here on this middle row. I got men that stand around me as I'm slicing it. You know what they want? They want a taste. But it's not in fullness. See, at Thanksgiving, you might get a taste. It gives you a sample of what's to come. See, the time period of now that we live in, now, as Paul said, this now that you're in right now, it's just a taste. It's in part. You ever wonder why some people get healed and some people don't? Because it's not in fullness, even though it's in the atonement. It's just a taste. You think you know all there is to know about God? You just got a taste. There's going to be a period of time when not only does the scripture say you have the mind of Christ, but you'll really have the mind of Christ. There'll be a period of time where you really can touch anybody that's ever sick and they'll come every time. It's called the millennial reign. Don't think everybody in millennial reign is going to be like you. You realize the only people that you're going to get a glorified body? That's part of your salvation. Do you realize that? Most people don't realize what salvation really is. It says in the book of Hebrews, did I finish what I was talking about there, Joy? Where was I at?
They tasted the good word.
Yeah, the taste. We talked about that. Yeah, it's a taste. We're in a period of time where we see things dimly. We look in the mirror, what? Dimly. Don't have a big old ego thinking you know everything. Shut up. Stop it. Humble yourself. Have ears to hear what the Spirit is saying. Because you'll always should be learning and taking in a new piece of pie. Learn something new. If you know the same thing next year as you do this year, you wasted a year. And I hadn't done my job. I'm here to challenge what you know so you can grow in the wisdom of the Lord. Man, I tell you what, it's such a release to me. I've prayed for so many people and they haven't gotten well. I've prayed for some and they have. Why didn't they all get well? Because I heal in part. Wow. You understand that? But it's all part of the atonement. Now, I want you to turn to the book of Ephesians. Ephesians chapter 2. And I want you to see this. Now, remember, we've been given the ministry of reconciliation. What you have is, you have these two words that make the word atonement. We were once Adam was once one with God, but became separate. Because, you know, the scripture says it this way. All men have what? Sinned and come short of the glory of God. Well, guess what? Most people think the verse is saying that all men have sinned and that sin makes them short of the glory of God. That's not what it's saying. See, all men have sinned because they're short of the glory of God. What's the glory of God? Say His Spirit. Is God going to judge the ungodly? Say yes. Do you know what the word ungodly means? Unlike God. Adam was like God. Adam became unlike God. Adam produced humans that were unlike God. Until you get born from above, you're unlike God. When you get born from above and get the Spirit of God placed inside you, you're now like God. Not Elohim. Not Trinity. Not Trinity. No, but you have the same. You're His child. You're now the children. See, you need to understand, Jesus' titles change. Jesus was the only begotten Son of God. Do you realize that? But He's not anymore. Now He's the first of many brethren. It's called a family. See, people under the law are servants. Everybody under the law on the old covenant were servants of God, not children. David, Moses, Elijah, they were servants. Jesus says this. He says, the least in the kingdom, say kingdom, is greater than even John the Baptist, who is the greatest of all men born of woman. How can the least in the kingdom, this goes back to your question, how can the least in the kingdom be greater than John the Baptist, the greatest? They were servants. We're family. We're not friends. We're family.
He says, I no longer call you servants, I call you a friend.
But we're family.
Yeah.
We're family.
But some families aren't friends either.
Let's not go there. We'll have counseling all night long. We're family. Does that mean we? No. We're families that should be about our Father's business. We're family that should be serving. Servants only do what they do to get their daily bread. That's why the prodigal son came back. He didn't come back to be family. He came back to be a servant because his father's servants have their daily bread. He didn't repent. Don't let anybody tell you he repented. He didn't come back to be a son. He came back to be a servant.
But he still got restored.
Not because of him, but because of his father.
Yeah.
His father brought him back. He didn't bring himself. The other son that was there, what was his problem? He said, I've obeyed your commandments. All the... Obeyed his what? Commandments. And you've never done that for me. See, they mistitled. It's not about a story about a prodigal son. It's about a father that had two sons that didn't understand their father. How many people gone to church and obeyed all the commandments all their life, and they've never had what the... one returning God, because they've been under the law. This one was a son living under the law of the commandments of the father, not realizing he could have. And the father said, it's all been here for you all the time.
Yeah.
But he didn't see it because he was under the law, the commandments. He wasn't free as a son. Okay, hold it up quick. Got to shake it like that so I can see it. Because I'll ignore it. I'll go like this. Okay, that's a rabbit trail. Sorry. So Ephesians chapter 3, verse 14.
3 or 2?
3. Ephesians chapter 3, verse 14. For this reason I bow my knees to the Father of our Lord Jesus Christ, for whom the whole family in heaven... I'm sorry, Joy, you are correct. Ephesians chapter 2, verse 14. For He Himself is our... See, atonement is the reestablishment of peace. See, God is going to judge sin by the blood. He's also going to judge the sinner. It's called His wrath. But in atonement, not only is the sin paid for, but so is the anger toward, like I was saying, Bert's wall fell on my dog. There was something that happened to pay the price for sin, and that's the blood, or the blood of Jesus in our case. But now, there had to be something happen to appease the wrath of God for our sake. Look what it says here. For He Himself is our what? Peace. Who has made both one, has broken down the middle wall of what? Separation. Having abolished in His flesh, next time you take communion, quote this scripture, What did he do in his flesh? He abolished what was separating us, keeping us from being in relationship. I'm going to say it this way. I know this is going to be hard for some people. Sin is not what separates you from God. It's not having His Spirit that separates you from God. The Scripture says, approach the throne of grace boldly in the time of need. Do you realize in this flesh you're going to have sin? When are you supposed to approach the throne of grace boldly in the time of need? When you're sinning! It's your. Why can you approach the throne of grace boldly in the time of need? Because your family. You realize servants have to wait in line, but family can cut in line. You don't have to enter the gates with thanksgiving, enter the courts with praise. You don't have to go through this process and wait in line. You can approach.
We can enter boldly.
We just said that. Enter the boldly. Boldly. You can go see your daddy. You're not a servant under the law. You're family. Let me read this. Having abolished in his flesh the enmity, that is the law of commandments contained in ordinances, so as to create in himself one new man. Not this one and not this one. Not right and wrong. Wrong or right, but one new man. God is doing something different between this one and this one that's never existed before. It's called us. A new creature. A new creation that never existed. Having abolished in his flesh the enmity, that is the law of commandments contained in ordinances, so as to create in himself one new man from the two, thus making peace. See, God's not mad at you anymore. He's not mad at Adam in you anymore. Because you're not of that anymore. He's made peace. And that he might reconcile, verse 16, them both to God in one body through the cross, thereby putting to death the enmity. What's verse 17 say? And he, that's capital letters, came and preached peace to you. What did he preach? What did Jesus preach? Judgment, wrath, hellfire, and brimstone? Sin? No! The same ministry that Paul had with the ministry of reconciliation that established peace, Jesus came to preach. What? He came and preached peace to you who were afar off, that's Gentiles, and those who were near, that's Jews. For through him we both have access by one Spirit to the Father. See, I think it looked something. See, God in 2 Corinthians chapter 5, we just read it. I hope we did. 2 Corinthians chapter 5, it says this. Verse 19, that is that God was in Christ reconciling the world to himself, not imputing their trespasses to them, and has committed to us the word of what? Reconciliation. Has Jesus paid the price? Has God, through Jesus Christ, paid the price for all man's sin? Say yes. That is the good news, people. It's not telling the world how bad they are. It's telling them that God is so good, their sins have been paid for. Let's finish reading it. Now we are ambassadors for Christ, as though God were pleading through us. We implore you on Christ's behalf, be reconciled to God. God has already made peace with... What was the first thing the angel said when Jesus came to earth? Glory to God in the highest and on earth. Peace. It's the gospel of peace. God's at peace with man, but man's not at peace with God. This says right here. Now then, we are ambassadors for Christ, as though God were pleading through us. We implore you on Christ's behalf, be reconciled to God. See, Bert did what he could to take care of what he did. He can be at peace with me, but that doesn't mean I'm at peace with him. God did. For God so loved the world, he gave his only begotten Son, that whosoever believeth. He did what he did to make peace with us, with all men. But this is saying the word that they were given, that we need to make peace with God. We're still holding ourselves guilty when he has set us free. We're telling the world that God hates them and going to judge their sin has already been judged by God through Jesus Christ. I think it looks something like what you're going to see. What you're going to see, at the very first, you'll see a stake, Jesus in a garden, and a figure. That figure represents Satan. While she's getting that ready, let me continue on. What we need to understand is God has made peace. The purpose of atonement is so we can be reconciled. Once we're reconciled, it's justification. You know what justification means? Just if I'd never done it. Now you're just as if Adam had never done it. And then you're sanctified. You're set apart. And so you have atonement. You have reconciliation. You have justification. Your relationship is back with God, just like you had never done anything. And once you've been justified, you're set apart. You're sanctified. God desires we be sanctified how? Spirit, soul, and body. We've already, see, salvation is a perfect tense word. It's past, it's present, and it's future. You were sanctified in your spirit, you're being sanctified in your soul, and you've yet to be sanctified in your flesh.
Vicente Cloven! soldiers tried to clear the narrow stream. But the crowd pressed in to see the man condemned to die on Calvary. He was bleeding from a beating. There were stripes upon his back, and he wore a crown of thorns upon his head. And he bore with every step the scorn of those who cried out for his death. Down the Via Dolorosa, all the way of suffering, like a lamb came the Messiah, Christ the King. But he chose to walk that road out of his love for you and me. Down the Via Dolorosa, all the triste día en Jerusalén, los soldados le abrían paso a Jesús, mas la gente se acercaba para ver al que llevaba aquella cruz.
Hebrews chapter 9, verse 23. Therefore, it was necessary that the copies of the things in heaven should be purified with these, but the heavenly things themselves with better sacrifice than these. For Christ has not entered the holy place made with hands, which are copies of the true, but into heaven itself, now to appear in the presence of God for us.
What verse?
Verse 25. Not that he should offer himself often as the priest entered the most holy place every year with blood of another. He then would have had to suffer often since the foundation of the world. But now, once, at the end of the ages, he has appeared to put away sin by the sacrifice of himself. And that it is appointed for men to die once, but after this, the judgment. So Christ was offered once to bear the sins of many. To those who eagerly wait for him, he will appear a second time, apart from sin. When Jesus comes back a second time, it's not going to be cause of sin, because he dealt with sin. The Bible tells us we're going to receive a glorified body. We're going to rule and reign. Apart from sin, the next two words in the Greek read this way, and bring salvation. He is bringing. See, right now we have salvation in part, but the fullness of salvation is coming with the second coming of Jesus Christ. He is bringing salvation in its completeness. And we're going to end with that because it's getting long and people are getting chilly. But what I want you to understand is salvation is a perfect tense word. You were saved. You're being saved. And you've really yet to experience the greatness and grandeur of salvation through Jesus Christ. Amen. Father, we thank you for this opportunity you give us to gather together in this your place. Holy Spirit, you're the great teacher. I simply ask that you do what you do best. Teach us. Open the eyes of our understanding. Help us repent. Help us change the way we think, so we line up according to your word. And all God's people said, amen.
Appreciate your prayers and your financial blessings. Your support also helps us to continue to share this message of grace, peace, and Christ's righteousness in the finished work of the cross. You can give online at CokerMinistries.com, or you can mail your support to or prayer requests to Coker Ministries, 15239 550 Fifth Avenue, Parkers Prairie, Minnesota, 56361. We pray God's blessings over you. Thank you for joining Pastor Curtis and Joy for this message. If you would like to hear more from Pastor Curtis or Joy, please check them out on their Coker Ministries YouTube channel. Also, please like and subscribe if these messages are a blessing to you. You can also visit their webpage at CokerMinistries.com. God bless you. Have a great day. Remember, if you are in Christ, you are blessed, highly favored, and so very deeply loved. Again, thank you for joining us in the Word. Be blessed.